Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. I'm Liz. I am a student here at University of Michigan. I'm on the Student Sustainability Initiative Board with my colleagues here. The Student Sustainability Initiative is a student-run program that's sort of a liaison between the students and the administration for sustainability on campus. We're really excited to have our guests here today for our panel. We've got Andy Hoffman, our moderator, who is a professor here of sustainable enterprise. Then we've got Andy Buchsbaum, the Vice President of Conservation Action at the National Wildlife Federation and the Interim Executive Director.
For one of our farms.
Yeah. Great. next, we've got Diane Holdorf, the Chief Sustainability Officer and Vice President of Environmental Stewardship, Health, and Safety at the Kellogg Company. And finally, we've got John Viera, the Global Director of Sustainability and Vehicle Environmental Matters for Ford. Just want to remind you all that we are taking comments and questions via these Twitter avenues, so feel free to do that during the panel, and we are also live streaming it, the link you can find on our Facebook page. Did I miss anything? Great!
Reception.
Oh, and afterwards there's a reception in the league. We can all walk over together after that. Great, so we'll get started.
Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming out on such a beautiful day. We never know when attendance is going to drop off, when it's beautiful or when it's raining. I'm not sure which one is the one that scares the most people away. But we're glad you're here, and the topic today is old problems, new solutions. And that could connote a number of different things. I'm curious how you read that title, what brought you into the room. But we have two corporate representatives and one nonprofit representative. In a time where conversations over environmental issues, sustainability, are pretty critical, given some recent events in Washington and what's been happening since then. So I suspect that is on your mind, and we will get to that. But we'd like to begin by just laying some groundwork of just how these folks approach sustainability, environmental issues within their organizations. And so we want to just start by just, how do you guys frame these issues? You could think about the audience here, and I'm guessing we've got a number of students here who will want to work in an organization like yours or yours. How do you make the case for environmental sustainability within your organizations?
Well, I guess I'm going to go ahead and get started, all right? So, you know, how do we make the case at Ford? So when we talk, one of the real focuses that we have at Ford is when we talk about sustainability, we want to drive sustainability into all of our operations, right? So in operations, it could be product development, manufacturing, our finance organization, human resources, our philanthropic arm of Ford. Every organization, when you think about, you know, the three legs of sustainability, financial, environmental, and social, are likely going to be working already on actions in the sustainability space. And what our core sustainability organization does is it then works with those organizations to set goals that they can deliver for that organization. So it's not about, you know, the central group is the only group that's working on sustainability. We really rely on all of the different functions to deliver sustainability. And our role is to do that translation for them, to say, okay, if you're in purchasing, and you're trying to think about, you know, you're the procurement activity, you're trying to think about, well, you know, what should we be doing? Well, a space that's really ripe are human rights and working conditions, right, in our supply base, going deep in the supply base, you know. So what actions and what goals can we set so that they can deliver that? So that's how we actually make the case for sustainability in the company, make it relevant to the operations that are part of our broader organization.
About the food and the ingredients and how and where we source them and how that food is made. We know that you probably pick food that you love because it tastes great, but how many of you actually really think about where your food comes from also? And who's growing it, how it was grown, what conditions, right? These things really matter. And we know that they matter more and more. So that reflects in the work that we do, not just in our own operations, where we're in the second decade of our commitments to be good stewards of the environment with our operations around water and greenhouse gases and waste, but equally in how we are sourcing our ingredients. We don't own farms anywhere in the world, but we purchase vital ingredients, corn, wheat, rice. These are some of the grains that really sustain populations all over the world. So we believe that we have a role to play, not just in the quality and quantity of supply that we buy for our foods that people love, that we have to make taste great and be responsible, but also to those farmers and those communities where we're sourcing those ingredients. So we have great programs on the ground with NGO partners, with supplier partners, with academic and research organizations to help understand where are those challenges at the farm level and what's our role in convening resources to do something about it, and then how do we help tell that story of those farmers, of the ingredients, and eventually of the food to folks like you who we know really care about that. So in our roles as sustainability leaders, we're looking not just at these broad issues of food security and ensuring that there's not just enough for our business, but frankly enough for all in our role as a leader at the global stage on that issue, but equally, how do we take what we are doing and turn that into transparent, engaging ways of talking about our purpose and what the differentiators are with the work that we're trying to do to make a difference. So it's actually incredibly exciting times, has very interesting and unique challenges as well, but has some really compelling elements to it because we get to work all the way from farm to table, from hunger to overindulgence. All of these issues kind of come together when we think about food. So it's fun work.
Can I push a little more? We were talking before this started about what just happened with United Airlines, which I'm sure you're all aware of. And Andy made the comment that if they, you know, apparently they got to $800 before they decided to forcibly remove this passenger from the plane. And if it had gone to $1,000, it could have saved them millions of dollars and the headaches that they're dealing with right now. And we went from there to the issue, do you have to monetize these things to people to attend to it? So in your organizations, to frame it, does it always have to have a dollar sign on it?
It doesn't always have to have a dollar sign on it, but we do separate what's pure philanthropic versus what does have some value, and that value would get to a level of monetization potentially. So let me give an example. I gave the example of working with our supply base to make sure that the working conditions are right in our supply base. Because if we have, you know, a supplier who supplies to another supplier who supplies to us, and they're using child labor, or let's say they have terrible working conditions in their facility, right, there's a reputational hit because, right, the message is going to be, you know, Ford's using child labor, or there's terrible conditions. But from a monetization standpoint, what we could easily show is that when we improve the working conditions in that supply base, the quality of the parts coming out of that supply base is going to be much better. And there's clearly a cost associated with better quality parts coming in, you know, less rejects. So oftentimes, it's not a pure monetization, but everybody could get their heads around, oh, yeah, better working conditions, better quality. We know just, you know, theoretically and practically, that's going to mean less cost to us, so therefore it's the right thing to do.
Same with Kellogg, that you have to monetize the delivery of the food, the quality of the food, in order to recognize climate change?
So outcomes matter, and metrics matter. And when we can put measurement to it, and we can embed the work, as John was saying, into the daily work streams of those who are really engaging on the line or in procurement, it makes a difference because that's how it then gets done on an ongoing regular cadence. When you start to talk about climate change, Andy, as you leaned into, that's hard sometimes for people to put their heads around. We have people who work in the manufacturing environment. They know how to measure energy usage. They know how to measure water usage. They know that, you know, as a company, we save $28 million by getting more efficient and reducing the energy and water that we use. But it's harder to do that with the greenhouse gas emissions, right? We set very aggressive targets as a company. Climate change is a critical issue for us as a business. It affects everything from how we source our ingredients to how we access the water and how we have license to operate. We put very aggressive commitments out there. We were in the climate negotiations at Paris and Marrakesh with governments showing that we're here as business helping to lead, as Ford was as well. We all have a role in this. We haven't monetized that. But it doesn't change the fact that we have intentional outcomes and very specific goals and targets that we're working towards. And because it's inevitably connected to energy use, either in our own operations or all the way down to the farm level, it's easier to determine what do those practice changes then correlate to, so that people feel like they have win-wins. They can be doing this work and achieving the goals that we've set out while hitting what are inevitably their other objectives in the business as well.
That requires some clever, smart communication.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You have to do that, what we call that translation, right? It's not a direct, oh, I can see the money for that action, so therefore I can get my head around doing it.
If I could jump in, I think the some of the debate, and I don't know from your perspectives, but we've seen this in the policy debates around monetization and how that plays with sustainability policy and actions, comes to the question of what time frame are you looking at? And the idea that we would monetize certain behaviors that you can see in the next quarter or the next year, that's actually a more accurate representation of what that might cost or not cost than when you go 3, 5, 10, 25, 100 years out. From our organization's perspective, we're looking at least 30 years out now. And we are not monetizing to determine what the best sustainability path is, where there are other values involved. But the monetization actually can help us if we can generate the right numbers, if we can identify the right numbers. Because what we found from our organization's standpoint and others is that when the mission of the organization lines up with sustainability practices, then you move forward rapidly. When the mission and the sustainability practices diverge, then when the sustainability practices, when the mission requires tough decisions, sustainability practices fall off. And so we're finding that, I mean, my organization is, we're National Wildlife Federation. We are not the panda. That's World Wildlife Fund. We are at Ranger Rick. So just to get that clear up front. That's a very critical component of our sustainability, is making sure you knew the difference between the panda
and Ranger Rick.
But when we look at sustainability, our mission is to make sure that wildlife survives over the next generation, and that's actually in question. 58% of the world's wildlife populations have declined. There's been a 58% decline in wildlife populations throughout the world in the last 40 years, including over 70% of marine species. These are vertebrates, not invertebrates. I'm sure you've read the sixth extinction, which talks about species, but we're just talking about numbers. Perfect. Well, then you can tell me what that's about. And there are various, I mean, there's climate change causes, there's monoculture, agriculture, invasive species, wildlife diseases. When you get into this, pollution, when you get into this, the sustainability requirement for our mission means that we kind of have to deal with all of that. And so we're looking at a 30-year basis. But from a monetization standpoint, very difficult to monetize that on the one hand. On the other hand, you pick a piece. The Graham Institute, this university, was a major player in developing a study on what are the economic benefits of restoring the Great Lakes ecologically. If you invest $20 billion in the Great Lakes, you get about $80 billion back, 4-to-1. Now, we had a message all along, the Great Lakes are a way of life, they're for family memories, they're drinking water, they're swimming, they're valuable, they transcend money. We came up with that study and suddenly we're, you know what, this is worth 4-to-1 investment return. And that was the thing that swayed the argument, not because the other things weren't true, but because when you add that to it, and it all lines up in the same way, you make remarkable progress.
But you know, I'm picturing the conversations within NWF. It's about values, and then when you go outside, you translate that through monetizing it. Is something lost in translation?
We actually had. That's why you work on your message, and in this case, it was not. In other cases, that can come back and bite you. I mean, we've done economic cost or environmental cost benefit calculations for regulations, and generally, the benefit side is under calculated, and the cost side is over calculated. So the regulations always look like they cost more than they benefit. Not always, but they tend to go that way. So there's a huge dearth of data and modeling that would actually allow you to cost out the real cost of climate change, the real cost of pollution, and the real benefits of getting at that. So it can go both ways, but the environmental community has long said we hate monetizing, we hate cost-benefit, when actually we can use that as well as anybody else and to support our value.
Is there a comparison to your particular departments within your companies to NWF where in your meetings, are you talking about values, and then when you go out into the organization, you translate it monetarily to try and get people to attend to this? Are you guys closet environmentalists?
I don't think anybody believes in a closet environmentalist. I've never had too much of my sleep there, but I was in a meeting right before I left to drive over here this afternoon with the guy who's the senior vice president of our North American supply chain, and we were talking about how we're aligning the goals of our public commitments with the goals and objectives of the other teams who are driving big internal programs so that they're reporting out not just on the cost savings and the operating efficiencies, but also on the total waste reduced and the total energy reduced and the total water reduced, so that we have that information coming out together from those operational teams who are actually driving the charge, because they then see how it all connects. So that was just one meeting today, for example.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, I'm going to switch from the environment to the social side. So to answer your question, Andy, you know, oftentimes it does start with the values. And so there's a few individuals in my organization that work on social sustainability, right? How are we having a positive impact in the communities that we're in? So, you know, one area that we definitely want to grow is in sub-Saharan Africa, right? You know, in terms of vehicles and, you know, how do we have more of a presence in sub-Saharan Africa? So this particular group said, well, we want to have an impact on the communities there. So they put together this project, which is pretty substantial right now, where we're partnering with, and I won't name the companies, but beverage companies, medicine companies, health companies. And basically what we're doing is we're taking our pickup trucks in sub-Saharan Africa, in Gambia, and in Nigeria right now. And for a lot of the outlying areas, those, you know, the population out there has no access to many things, right? They don't have access to water, they don't have access to food, to medicines, to education. And we're actually using the vehicles with our various partners, because the partner is the beverage company that might sell a particular soda, right, is interested in getting their water out to the village. Well, we have this platform to do that, right? So now we have this very cool business model where we're getting these services, right, food and everything, out to the villages. And we said, that's great from a value standpoint. See, we're having a positive impact on the community. Well, our marketing team came along and said, this is like incremental, right, market opportunity for us. We were that wasn't even a market to serve. And why it's small right now, there's actually, you know, there is a cost and a profit benefit in that particular project. But I have to be honest, right? We didn't go in thinking, you know, this is great. We're going to really serve these communities out there, and we're going to make a ton of money. It really all started with what can we do to serve the communities. And as we engaged more of our broader organization, there was a marketing group that came forward and said, hey, and there's also some profit opportunity. So sometimes it actually moves in that type of a sequence.
This next question I'd like you to start with, Andy, because lest we all start holding hands and sing kumbaya, that everything's just wonderful. These are exemplar companies that have come out and really staked a position on sustainability. What is the rest of the corporate sector like? Are they outliers? Or, you know, you've worked with a lot of companies. Are they outliers? Should they be representative of what people expect from the corporate sector in general?
I think they're unusual, usually good, and thank you for leading the companies the way you have. I think one of the questions that I have for any company, and it actually we're looking in the mirror for nonprofit organizations as well, is how much of what you're doing is changing the culture of the institution, and how much is doing tactical things to look good. And from my conversations with you over time and some of the others in the Graham Advisory Board, these companies are making commitments to changing their culture, and that's really hard to do. And it's long-term, and it's a slow slog, and you don't get it all right at the same time. I personally identify with that because the National Wildlife Federation and the environmental organizations are facing the same culture challenge when it comes to diversity, equity, and inclusion, which for our internal purposes, that's our sustainability challenge with a very white, older male cohort, leadership, board members. It's changing slowly. And finding that internally that the culture change is the hardest, and to actually make it so that the culture is going to be younger, more diverse, more inclusive, and more representative of the country and the world, which we need to be if we're going to survive as a environmental or conservation organization. So that culture piece is critical. A lot of companies, if they are forced into addressing sustainability issues, it's not a cultural thing, and it doesn't last. Because as soon as that mission and the sustainability piece diverge, the culture is with the mission. It's not with sustainability. Sustainability leaves. In fact, and there, many folks are just can be very cynical about the whole thing. Says, let's just do some PR things to make ourselves look good for the crisis of the day, and then move on.
You should have thoughts on that, and you don't have to use names, but you're part of massive supply chains. You have a lot of competitors. You have a global reach. Actually, you see a lot of companies.
Yeah, go ahead, Dan.
I think my view would be a little bit more optimistic than Andy's. We work with a lot of peers, and particularly at the global level, companies like ours in a lot of different sectors are operating in a way that even governments can't, because we're operating in a transboundary situation. So our businesses are inherently linked to the success of communities and watersheds and other economic drivers that really go beyond policy and the ability of government to address these issues. So from a business perspective, as well as a reputation and engagement perspective, these things are really almost imperatives. What we see with smaller companies, there's not always the resources to make it happen. It's not easy, right? John has shared some of those examples. We have them as well. So not every size organization has the resources to take it to the level that perhaps Ford and Kellogg have done. But as we look to the startups who are challenging us the most, this is in their DNA. They've started their business with this as their leading platform. And that's a very different way of thinking about it again. And that, I think, is equally important in driving us and all of those in between.
So you're thinking about the organic startups?
This is not your guess. Yes, but any kind of small food startup generally is leading in this space one way or another.
Can we say the same thing about Ford? Tesla is snipping at your heels right now.
They are. They are. And I'll touch on Tesla because that's a topic that we all like to talk about. And does anybody out here have a Tesla that I can drive?
So I have two C-Maxes and the new cheaper Tesla on order.
Is that right?
And John, if you get in a Tesla, I'm taking a picture.
You're taking a picture? You can drive Diane C-Max, though. How does that sound?
Both of them.
Okay, I'm coming over. Before I get to Tesla, I want to touch on culture, because I think what Andy brought up is really important. I mean, changing the culture so that it really becomes part of the DNA, as I talk about how we really want to drive sustainability in the operations. If the culture was right, it'd be easier to do that. And, you know, we're making a lot of progress at Ford, and I'd like to be able to say it's because, man, my team does a great job going around changing culture. You know, that's not actually the case. The reason that the culture is changing is two things. Number one, actually there's a lot of existing employees that have maybe been, you know, hidden that are coming out and saying, hey, this stuff matters to us as employees, right? And I'll tell you what, you want to get senior leadership and any company to listen, when your employees start talking, that makes a big difference. The second biggest driver, and is probably the biggest driver, is all of you. The new employees that we have coming in, I mean, they're demanding us to be an ethical company. What are we doing to make a difference? I mean, and I'm talking about the top talent is looking absolutely at that. So, you know, it becomes a business imperative that if we want to get that top talent, like many of you, we better be thinking about changing our culture, because if we had the old culture mindset of just doing less bad and everything's about optimizing profits, I'll tell you what, we would not be getting the talent. And I think that's having maybe the biggest impact, not our organization. So, but I think it is critically important to change that culture.
Turn the question now back on the nonprofit world. I mean, you guys are a very collaborative organization. Outstretched hand, let's work together. There are other organizations out there that are the rock throwers. Do we need more rock throwers to get movement going, or is Andy's Way the way to go? Or is it just a mix of both?
It's a mix, and people have different roles. I have to disclose that I'm a recovering attorney, and I actually used to sue companies for violations of all sorts of environmental laws. And so I was, in so many ways, one of the rock throwers early. I used to work for the Pergs before they were the Environment Americas, and so and for Ralph Nader. So I've been, you know, certainly Ralph Nader is certainly not somebody who's known for working closely with others. Those of you who are, you know, of a certain age, remember when he was actually an icon that was really standing up against the whole corporate society. And I'm sure that John still has.
We had a little interface. The auto industry did with
Mr. Nader. Yeah, a little scars Nader. For that. But to answer the question more directly, there are different roles for different folks, and that's. As long as folks are talking to each other in our community, that's fine, on the one hand. On the other, there is a kind of a fundamental split right now, or has been for quite some time in the conservation community, which in the environmental community, and it goes back to really, you know, early 1900s, and that is, are we doing this to conserve wildlife, conserve nature, or are we doing this as a part of a broader progressive movement? There are many organizations that put themselves in.
Can you explain the second one more?
The progressive movement is okay. So, we should be allied. Sierra Club, Lead Conservation Voters, others. The idea is that there are progressive causes that go beyond conservation and environmental causes, and they may be maybe causes in terms of fair wage, anti-discrimination, LGBTQ. There's all sorts of causes that kind of have been traditionally in the progressive wing and that are supported by Democrats. And as the progressiveness has gone more and more Democratic in one party, these organizations have become allies and in some ways partners with Democrats. The other wing of the conservation movement is basically saying we have to bring everybody in, no matter what party they are, and that means we need to be careful in what we focus on. We're going to focus more on the wildlife or the conservation side and try not to get into the issues that tend to divide society. Now, that's traditionally where National Wildlife Federation, some of the conservation organizations have been, which has allowed us to work with Republicans as well as Democrats. The tricky part is if you're looking forward from a sustainability lens, and you're looking at diversity, equity, inclusion, and you're looking at what society is going to be like, you can kind of see where history is taking us. And not addressing some of the social inequities is not really possible anymore. And so in that way, our culture and our decision-making is kind of like yours. How do you juggle, you know, how do you balance that? And so what we found is that a lot of it has to do with tone. And if you look at the publications that the various organizations put out, you could be saying the same thing in three different ways. It could be, let's all work together. It's the bad guys are the enemy and they're evil. Or it could be something about corporate polluters, which kind of splits the difference. And so how you speak and what your messengers are is really critically I'll stop there.
Let's transition to how much this conversation has changed since November.
And what hasn't?
and you know, how do you engage the debate? And John, if I can put you on the spot, there's got to be some very interesting conversations within Ford over let's keep moving on renewables and alternative drivetrains. And yes, this is going to be a big relief rolling those CAFE standards back. How has the conversation changed?
Yeah, it's interesting. So I don't know if it was in my bio when they introduced me. So I have two roles in the company. I'm in charge of the global sustainability, the sustainability efforts in the company. The other side of my responsibility, which I probably spend too much time on, is I have a global group that's responsible for all of the environmental regulation negotiations. So fuel economy and emissions, right? So here on the one hand, right, I have sustainability. On the other hand, I am negotiating the regulations. And it's been a big challenge in the U.S., right, since the election. We were, as we look at new environmental standards for vehicles, fuel economy standards, it's absolutely a matter of automakers and the regulators working together, right, to come up with solutions, right? And you agree upon a solution, usually it's a compromise, but those solutions are always all about how are we moving forward with technology, right, to improve the environmental footprint of the vehicles. And that's what the end game has always been about. With the recent election, the problem is, and you know, Andy had mentioned, you know, this politicizing that's going on right now. There's been a huge separation around, do we not do anything with regard to moving forward from a regulation standpoint? Because maybe one side says, hey, we don't, you know, we're going to just eliminate all regulations. Do we go down the path that we have been on that says we got to continuously make the changes? And when we continually make the changes, are you now alienating this other side that you're going to need for things like, you know, tax reform and other? So it becomes very complicated, right? Because you're, you know, you're working with an entity, you know, in the White House right now that has, you know, multiple facets that are going to impact our business. The environment is one facet, but there are other facets as well. So we're threading this needle to want to continue to move forward from a regulation standpoint. So we're not saying let's roll back regulations. We want to continue to move forward. But we also need to talk to the White House around some of the other issues that are there. And oftentimes, just because we're talking to the White House, or if our CEO or our executive chairman has a picture with the president, it sometimes sets off, let's say, the other side, and it has nothing to do with what we're trying to accomplish on the environmental side, but just because a picture was taken with the president in the White House, it actually causes a lot of disruption. So it's been very challenging to stay focused on what are all of the goals that we set up, you know, when President Obama was in the White House, when President Bush was in the White House. We have long-term goals that we're trying to stay on that path. And I think what's happened since the election, there's just a lot of distractions that want to get us off that path. And it's just really hard to make sure we stay focused and stay on the path and talk to a lot of external groups like NGOs to say, don't, you know, what the press is saying is not actually what we're doing. We need to have dialogue around what we're doing so that we can continue to move forward and make progress.
There's a nice distinction between your two companies, because you're touching on issues around climate change and more around mitigation.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yours is around adaptation. And we were talking earlier that you are seeing shifts. It's like, duh, yeah, climate change is happening. Yeah. Kellogg was present in Paris. So do you look at what's happening in Washington with a different view than John does?
Well, I think our sectors are quite different. So the challenges that we're going to face, some of the challenges that we're going to face in the change in administrations are going to be therefore different. Now, it's not going to change our approach to how we're addressing climate change, to how we're preparing for business continuity and supply for our ingredients, to the work that we're doing with farmers already today on the ground in the U.S., where we do tend to talk more about conservation practices and conservation agriculture and changing weather patterns, because we want to have an engaged outcome, not a difficult discussion. But it doesn't, at the end of the day, change the work. And we're going to continue to do that work. And one of the things that we've heard from others, primarily in food and beverage, but also in some of the other sectors, is that we think that there's going to be actually an increased blend of business leadership in this space. While the U.S. government, at any rate, sorts out what its positions will be. And if it changes at the federal level, we'll inevitably see changes at the state levels. But it doesn't change what we have to do outside of the U.S. every day anyway.
Right, right.
So our path is clear. Our path is able to continue. There's really urgent drivers behind all of this work. That's why our companies are doing it also. And yes, it's also the right and necessary thing to do. So all of that's going to keep our momentum going forward.
And to put that back on you, John,
is
it fair to say that the auto market is driven more by external markets than by domestic markets, that the American consumer?
It is. And it's a great point. So I was giving my views on, you know, what's changed here in the U.S. since November. But I probably, I mean, the U.S. market is probably 30% of my portfolio. So actually, the U.S., yeah, I mean, there's disruption right now in the U.S. market. But in other years, there's disruptions in other markets. I mean, China has always been a challenge in terms of the negotiations that we've had there and the disruptions that we've seen. So we are a global company. The good news is, you know, Diane mentioned that you kind of put together a plan and you execute that plan. Because we have global products, right, those global products need to work really in all countries, right? So this notion around, well, if the new administration is going to, you know, roll back regulations, you know, we're going to take a completely different path. Not really, right? Because we have these vehicles that we need to sell throughout the world with regulations throughout the world that in many cases are more stringent than the regulations in the U.S. So we're not going to bite off a unique strategy just for the U.S. during these 4 years. We need to sell these products globally. So again, it's a distraction, but we remain on the path that we are on because we actually are selling vehicles globally.
Those are great points. Now, what we're finding is not that the new administration or Congress is doing things that are surprising in terms of the rollback, in terms of regulatory rollbacks that they're having an impact. Because that takes a while. It's checked by the courts. There are laws that actually require certain regulations. There are certain things on climate change that they can do right away or try to do, but it's going to be tough for them to do that. And this has been part of one party's platform for a long time, so that's not surprising. And we were seeing some attacks on science and climate change, particularly. I was surprised by two things. First off, is that the rhetoric on climate change has changed since the election. The climate change was highly polarized when it was an issue that was being promoted by Obama because that was something that the Republicans would say, this is an overreach and this is exactly why you have to throw out the Democrats because they're working on climate change. And they really were very anti-science, some of the climate skeptics and the like. And they're still there. But now you're getting rhetoric from the Republican Party saying, you know, climate change is real. We have to do something about it because they're in power. They have all three branches of government, really. And so it's no longer a partisan issue.
No.
It is. It's partisan, but in a different way. Now it's you're getting now 20 House Republicans or more signing up for saying we need to do something on climate change. You've got the carbon tax folks. The rhetoric on the hard climate skeptics is there, but in the middle, kind of the rational middle now, is becoming rational, and more rational, less partisan. So that's not necessarily going to result in change because the folks at the top really have demeaned science in all so many ways. But it does give me a little bit of hope that there might be some ways, particularly working with corporate partners who know this stuff is needs to get dealt with, that we actually might get some stuff done. Prevent the worst from getting done. The thing that's most frightening is we actually thought that even after the elections in November that there were some really interesting things, federal policies that could get done. The infrastructure spending had enormous potential for wildlife funding, for water. There was forest management pieces that could get fixed. Mandates like the ethanol mandate is one that we've been fighting against because it promotes corn and soy growth in places that you don't want it and really has massive impacts on wildlife. Those are fairly major things. Problem is, the way this administration and Congress is unrolling is that there's hardly anybody you can find to talk to in the White House. I mean, there are maybe three dozen political appointments out of 500 that have been made in the White House and the agencies. And so what you're finding is you want to get something done, it's chaos. You can't. And that may change. And I don't know how you all are finding that. The agencies, Department of Interior, you've got the guy at the top, one guy behind him, and then there's like nobody else till you get down to professional staff. The EPA, everybody's interim. So that means that we'll do, if they want to do bad, they'll be much longer and won't be able to get it done. But if you actually want to get stuff done, it's much, much, much harder than we anticipated.
And is the environmental movement changing? Are you rolling up your sleeves more? Are you lawyering up more? Are you getting out your brass knuckles? What is happening in the movement?
Yes. all those.
So every NWF is changing its posture?
Yeah. Well, what's happening, this happened in 1981 when Reagan first got elected also. There's a put, the federalism matters, and so we're working in the states. The shift has gone more to the states, and this time the shift has gone much more to the private sector. Everybody's going to be needing to work much more with businesses that want to get stuff done, because right now the business sector is far different than it was in the 1980s, and is there are so many businesses that are involved in sustainability. This is not switching from what I said before, but there are many, many businesses that we would like to work with, and you're seeing, I think Diane's comment about the startups is key. The startup businesses are where the future is for the economy and the environment.
We'll go for about 10 more minutes, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. Are there mics, or we'll just have people shout out their questions? I think the answer. Oh, so do you want to let people fill out cards, or? Okay, so how will we do the questions? Okay, so she'll be walking around with cards if you want to ask a question, and then they'll hand them to me. But what advice do we have for the young people in the audience? They have devoted the life that they've lived so far, their college careers, whether it's an undergraduate or master's, or even a PhD, on sustainability issues. I presume that's why they're in the room. Is it a good time to be doing this? Is a bad time to be doing this? Should they be depressed? Should they be excited? What advice do you have for the young people in the room?
I think it's a really critical time, actually, Andy. I think that, Andy talked a little bit about this pivot point. We are at a time where the pressures on these issues are only going to continue to increase from all different directions. And the solutions, therefore, what we've done in the past isn't going to continue to work for us. So people are going to have to come in and really start looking at these things in very different ways, be it in companies, be it in NGOs, be it in policy advocacy groups, maybe not so much in the government in the interim for the near term here, but at the state level, that could be quite different again. So we're seeing where we see the biggest opportunity, and what I would encourage everybody here to think about is there really is no such thing as a pure sustainability role. Every single one of these roles is connected into a way of getting the work done. So how do you tie your passion in this space, which we all have, that's why we do what we do, to something that connects to a business purpose or an activist's purpose or whatever that space is in which you want to apply your time, energy, effort, and bring it to life that way. So for example, John talked about procurement. For our procurement team leaders who are working in categories where human rights and environmental risks are significant, they have to understand how to ask the questions that get to understanding if the risks are real or not. We can't do that for them, they have to do that. Some of the strongest up and coming procurement team members are those who are coming in with sustainability experience somehow in their education or work background. Same in manufacturing, same frankly in marketing, where we're seeing the best brand marketing team leaders are those who already understand how to convey their brand with the brand's purpose at the forefront. That's not something that we can create and translate. They have to be able to bring that lens to that work. Same with sales. When we go in and have conversations with Walmart or Wegmans or Target, they're putting pressure back on us to understand what are we doing in sustainability, what are we doing on energy, what are we doing on carbon, what are we doing on human rights. And even at the sales level, that becomes the differentiated strategic conversation opportunity with customers, making it not just a tactical exchange. So there's no question that this type of work that you're all invested in is going to continue to be really important. I think the opportunity is how and where do you want to get that work done? And then bring it to that space as well.
If I may, just if I hear some cynical thoughts in the audience right now in a time of Wells Fargo and things like that,
yeah.
Should we have hope in that the corporate sector is going to do the right thing.
So, just like there are people who do not care about these issues at the forefront of what they do, there are corporations who aren't going to put this stuff into the core of their values. You still got to pick who you want to work for.
Right.
John was saying, you know, we're seeing the same thing. We have everybody from our interns. I worked with our 150 interns last summer, and almost every single one of them, no matter what department they were assigned into, embedded sustainability into the project they deliver by the end of the summer. We're seeing the same thing with our leaders that are coming in at all kinds of levels. That's one of the reasons why people are coming to Ford or coming to Kellogg. That's probably why you'll look for those companies also. Will you go necessarily to those who are clearly not leading with this? No, would I if I wanted to make a career change? I wouldn't either, right? So, but you have to choose how and where you can apply and where you have shared values.
Okay. John, Andy?
Yeah, I'm just building on Diane's comment. I think it's a great, I mean, if you're passionate about sustainability, this is a great time. And you're wondering, why would I say it's a great time? Because there's huge challenges out there. And in my opinion, right, you want to get into, right, the fray when there's a lot of challenges because your passion can come up with solutions, right? We need innovation to solve a lot of these problems from an environmental and social standpoint. And that innovation just isn't technical innovation. I mean, it's business innovation. Whatever field you're in, there's going to be a need for innovation to really address and tackle these problems. And the bottom line is we need that, right? And companies need that. And I think the beauty behind all of you going into the marketplace versus when I went into the marketplace 30 years ago, right, there are textbooks that said, you know, when you come into the company, this is what you're going to do, and this is how you're going to do it, because we've been doing it the same way for the past 50 years, and we don't think, you know, anything's going to change, so that's the way it's going to be. I'll tell you what, everything is completely disruptive right now. So if we look internally at, okay, where's all the expertise that are going to figure out ways to solve these big problems? We have some, but we don't have everybody we need. A lot of that innovative thinking comes from the new talent that we're coming in. We're relying so much more on new talent over the last 5 years than we ever have. And if you have a passion in this space and can help bring solution or think about solutions, I think it's a great time. I think it's a fantastic time.
I completely agree. You don't want to work in Washington right now for the next few years, probably. That's kind of, for those interested in sustainability, I know that there's some morale issues happening in some of the big NGOs. But there is, everything has been disrupted. And this past election has increased that. And so there's so much focus now on what's happening locally and in companies in the States. One of the big things we haven't talked about, none of us represent this sector, although maybe you all know much better than I do, and that is that, you know, that the trends now that you all know probably better than I do is recent college graduates, those who are going to college now, are much more likely to be having multiple jobs in their careers than our generation was. And so what that means is that you're going to have many entrepreneurs, many small businesses, many consultants. You'll be part of that supply chain that John was talking about, not as because you have one client, but you have multiple clients, and the talent that Diane and John's companies needs, they're going to be going outside as consultants, or more and more consulting type work, more and more sole proprietors. And that means that you can get into sustainability in many, many more ways than one path. And you can do it differently depending on the job. And you can market yourself differently. So, and if you don't like what you're doing, you can move. And that's why attracting talent is so important for these companies, is because everybody can move. So I think it's an incredible time to be working in sustainability and to be working in innovation. And those two have to be hand in hand. You put them together, and there's no ceiling in what you can do.
Last question before we take questions from the audience. So those in the audience who may not be deciding to drive their career in this direction, but are here because they care about the environment, should they be scared? Is this a short-term blip? Is the long-term good? Or is this going to be some serious damage that will make the long-term bad?
I mean, my crystal ball, I'm usually too optimistic. I just, I just have a lot of faith in the human ingenuity in terms of solving the problems. My concern is, I'm saying because I don't want to be too Pollyanna, right? My concern is, when is that ingenuity going to really, when are we really going to tap into that ingenuity to really start solving the problems faster? So I have no doubt that we have the brain power to solve these problems, but is that urgency going to be kind of put on the table even more so than it is right now to get that ingenuity started? That's my concern, but I have full belief that, man, we could figure it out once we get working on it and get focused.
The way that I would build on that is that those of us who are here, how do I put this? As my husband always says, it is a young person's world. Why are the old people making the decisions? Right?
My kids say that too.
Yeah. And so there's no question these issues are going to continue to press and that we're going to have to work on them one way or the other. And the people who are perhaps leading in some of the directions that are not taking us towards solutions aren't going to be there forever, right? So we've got to be working in wherever spaces we can to ensure that we still are ready and still making the right kinds of forward progress. It's going to be different. It's not going to be as easy, and we're not going to have the policy leadership, and funding might become more challenging on the one hand and more available on the other. But I just see it almost as an inevitability. This is where we have to go. It's directionally the line of travel.
Yeah, I agree. We had a CEO a few years ago who would give talks on climate change that were incredible. I mean, they were a lot of information. He worked with Gore, and he would leave the talk, and people would just sit there stunned, and they'd say, "What? We should just go out and kill ourselves." I mean, it was like, and you know, it was accurate. But but what I think what those talks missed was that there's incredible passion. There's an about the outdoor world that cuts across every class, generation, every political party ideology. And for example, polling of Trump voters, not any Trump voter, but the folks who are really pro-Trump, a majority of them are very pro-environment. A majority of them think we need to take action on climate change. The debate, the real debate when you strip away the partisanship right now in Congress, the real debate is over what the solutions are. And that's where, if we can get to that debate, then we can actually make enormous progress. And climate change is not our only issue. I mean, there's all sorts of other things we got to worry about. But again, if we're forward thinking and looking at solutions, and if we have sustainability as part of our core, so it's not something separate, then I think there's enormous reason for hope.
Okay, here's a question. I mean, we often hear about companies moving plants to places with low wages. That's the primary variable. Do you ever think that companies would choose locations for new manufacturing based on a community level of concern for sustainability? Could it ever reach that level?
You're just going through my head as I think about that question.
That's a good question. Who asked that question? Raise your hand. Who is that? Give that person a free, okay, right there. Free tuition next term. Andy, make it happen. That's a good question. How about that?
I can Andy.
So I get to work on some of the teams that decide where we're going to source plants, and I get to work on some of the teams that get to figure out where are we going to source our ingredients. What we have to have for both is water, access to agricultural infrastructure, and strong, capable workforce. And those are not geographically unique, necessarily. They exist in a lot of different places. The biggest driver and the biggest challenge at this point tends to be access to water. And so as I thought about the question, as I reflected on it, for me it was a biodiversity, cultural community aspect, because what we're seeing increasingly in communities that have been, in this case, particularly water challenged, I'm sure you guys are what it takes to rejuvenate a watershed is a giant community effort. It's not any one single entity can do that, but that's what gives it viability as an ongoing location in which to do almost any kind of business. So I wouldn't have framed it within that, but I think it's a really interesting way to think about how we value ecosystem services and how we value educational capabilities. Those two pieces, to me, come to the core of what constitutes a sustainable community in which business is going to have to look to thrive.
Yep, that's a great answer.
Talent. I'd add one more to that.
Yeah.
And that this actually, that's the reason that the Great Lakes have gotten over $2.5 billion from the federal government over the last 5 years because of the Great Lakes restoration effort. That effort was won in part because of support by the Council of Great Lakes Industries. Council of Great Lakes Industries, which also supported a regulating themselves to make sure that water withdrawals from the Great Lakes stayed in the Great Lakes and that they were reasonable. Why would a set of companies do that? They viewed their competitive advantage over everybody else as being the Great Lakes because the water is plentiful, it's clean, and they wanted to keep it here and they wanted to keep it that way, but also because they viewed the Great Lakes, and particularly some of the cities in the Great Lakes, as places to attract talent, the talent you were talking about. And another study with Graham Institute and the Brookings Institution, there was that's part of the reason that there was so much economic value to Great Lakes restoration is because it will attract talent. And so I think it's already happened. I mean, there are companies located here have invested in making sure the Great Lakes get restored and in even regulating themselves. They didn't have to regulate themselves. In regulating themselves, supporting regulations or water withdrawals around the Great Lakes to make sure that they have a competitive advantage and their plants can stay here and open here.
The title of this session is Old Problems, New Solutions. And I think we've pushed a bit on new solutions. I think we could push further. We certainly could. But someone asked an interesting question. Switching gears from old problems, are there any significant new problems that are emerging in your organizations that should be a focus of conversation?
New problems in the organization versus new problems in society?
Well, new problems that you're facing in your organization that you're looking for solutions to. What are the emergent sustainability issues?
Do you want? Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, you got one.
Go ahead. You got one. You're ready. Go, Diane. Go.
One of the fastest growing pressure points that we see is driven by what is actually unprecedented migration today. We're seeing unprecedented numbers of people on the move because of conflict, because of food security, food system failure, because of all different kinds of adversity issues. And that puts a tremendous number of people at risk. And there are more people in forced labor, modern day slavery issue today than at any point in our cultural, in our history. And this puts our work, and you touched on this earlier, John, our work in ensuring that where we go all the way back to the farm or all the way back to the extraction of the materials that we use, how do we increase our level of visibility and transparency and understanding to know exactly what those labor practices are? And even closer to home in migrant farm labor here in the US, frankly, to understand, are there risks that we need to be aware of and what's our role in trying to address them? And there's a lot of forging of new paths in trying to figure that out. And those risks are moving quickly as these, as people are equally moving quickly. So that's something that I know many of us are trying to understand how to wrap our hands around and really get to literally the bottom of what those risks are and our role in it.
I, in terms of a challenge, it's not necessarily a brand new challenge. It's been an emerging challenge, and that's when you look at the population growth, right? So if you look at the global auto industry, right, between now and 2050, I don't know, the population is going to grow to what, Andy? Is it 9 billion? I mean, it's some crazy number. And when you look at the need for people to move in vehicles to support that 9 billion, we need to, like, double, right, just from a supply standpoint, we need to double, right, the amount of vehicles we put out there. So isn't that great? That's a great growth business, right? Woo, let's get in it. Let's go auto industry. That's fantastic. Little problem, though, right? There's a little bit of congestion going on right now in the world, right? So even though that's the need that we have in order to move people around, mobility, The problem is, with the current gridlock and you know, the growing density in cities, people aren't going to be able to move around with just putting out more vehicles. So the real challenge right now, and it's something that, you know, we're really trying to attack as a company, is how do we move from mobility in terms of just producing more cars to services so that we're moving people around, but maybe people don't own the vehicles anymore, right? I mean, I think there's still a need to be able to move people around, but, hey, they're not going to be able to own the vehicles. What kind of business does that look like? Completely different business, right? Completely new challenge for us, but that's the reality if we're going to want to stay in business the next 150 years because we can't just keep selling these cars. So it's a challenge, but I gave an opportunity.
Got a couple, many, but I'll limit it to two. One is referenced before, monoculture, agriculture. I know that Diane can refer to think about this too. That's one of the least understood, least studied, and least acknowledged massive habitat problems for wildlife and for people. The monarch butterfly extinctions or the reductions that we're seeing, 95% reduction in monarch butterfly, that's in part because we've gotten rid of all the milkweed. We've gotten rid of all the quote-unquote weeds that insects rely on. The pollinator crisis, bees, we're basically destroying the foundation of the food web by these massive, massive wheat, soy, and corn farms. And there's no regulation of that. We have incentives that make it more likely, and we try to create incentives to attack that, but those incentives so far are just kind of spitting in the wind. It's hugely market-driven. It's international market-driven. And as a result, you can track the people and wildlife impacts from that. If we don't get a handle on that, then a lot of the other things that we're trying to do in terms of ecosystems are just going to be blown away. And so that's a big one. That is, we can't address it, but it is big. Second piece which is not really related to this, but kind of everything, is the fragmentation of society because of the internet. And that's more of a political piece. It's something that we wrestle with every day. And when you don't ever have to listen to anybody who gives you information you don't like, when you basically are a part of an online tribe and you just stay in that tribe, then when society fractures, then it takes away that optimism we all feel that we can work together for solutions because there's no together there. So that's a big one.
Diane, I think this transitions a question directly at you and Kellogg. A lot of the food you produce is processed, and processed food is not always as healthy, and there are also some image issues with it. How far can Kellogg's go to educate consumers enough to champion different kinds of food and less processed food?
It's a huge challenge, and even what is processed food is a huge discussion. So. Had a huge role, not just from the Kellogg company, but from food companies generally, in how people continue to have nourishment on the move, and as we've expanded our population densities and growth, and a whole bunch of different very good drivers behind it. But it also leads to this real disconnect from what's in the food. What is it? Right? If I can't see every ingredient, which we can't always when we sit down for all of our meals, do I trust it? If I can't understand what, we have to do such a better job explaining what all the ingredients are. You know, we had policy that drove us to use the scientific names, but then I don't even know what it is, right? So how do you reverse the policy so that you can have understandable ingredient names that we can relate to, unpack? One of the things that we've tried to do to crack this very significant and real challenge is create a space in which we can have a direct one-to-one dialogue and create the space for much greater transparency. So we've got a website called www.openforbreakfast.com that we launched about 2 years ago. We now have it in a bunch of different countries. And it it is a place where we can get into a lot more information about our ingredients, where they're grown, the farmers, how we're sourcing it, the communities in which we're working, the hunger activities that we're doing there, the nutrient base of our food. We just opened a huge new sort of chapter within it that talks about every single ingredient that has a genetically modified seed associated with it, because there's no GMO labeling, and we were trying to have a federal solution for that, and that's obviously not going to happen. So how do we get to a place where everybody who wants that information can get there? And it's also a place where we can answer questions. Literally, any question that comes in, we answer it. We talk about pollinator health. We talk about corn monoculture, right? A lot of the things that we've talked about here, we've had to address and have had the opportunity to be more transparent about in Open for Breakfast. So there are other ways that we have to get better at that. We have a lot of, you know, it was funny, I was with some folks out on one of the rice farms in Arkansas where we source our rice for Rice Krispies, and one of the people said, hold on a second, you mean a Rice Krispie is just a puffed grain of rice? And I'm like, yeah. Like, oh my God, I thought it was like this mixed flour and they rolled it and then you baked it and had all this stuff in it. I'm like, no, it's just, it's a grain of rice. Right? And so how we kind of show that journey of the food from what it looked like at the farm level to what it looks like by the time we're eating it and choosing to share it with our families is a huge opportunity for us. And we're trying to figure out the best ways to do that.
So the shift, we started talking about how do you translate and drive change within your organization. Now we're talking about how you drive change outside your organization. And so, yeah. We have a question here. How do you speak to stockholders who may not like what you're doing and may be against your sustainability effort? And if I could tack on to that question, and how do you educate consumers more broadly that they should be paying more for this expensive drivetrain and emissions control system, that they should be paying more for organic food. How do you, and you can speak to this as well, Andy, how do you educate these external constituencies, stockholders, consumers, who are probably driven more by money than by values?
Well, yeah, I mean, I ask the marketing team all the time, why aren't you educating the customers so that they pay more for these vehicles, right? And they're not listening to me. I don't understand. That's their job. I think that from a customer standpoint, what I think we have the responsibility, right, as a consumer company, if in fact we need to do something to the vehicle to make it more environmentally friendly, I don't think the onus should be on the customer to have to pay more for that vehicle. We should be thinking about what's the value proposition that particular goods actually provides so that the customers want to pay more money. So let me give you an example, right? So, you know, we're looking at really electrifying our portfolio, right? We want to have more electrified vehicles in our portfolio. So, you know, we could go the traditional route and say, hey, there's fuel savings, you know, it's, you know, less electricity, you know, you're using electricity instead of gas, so therefore you're saving money, so you should be able to pay more. Well, you know, the price of gas is pretty low. As a matter of fact, in some parts of the U.S., it's actually cheaper to put gas in your vehicle than to actually charge your electric vehicle. So rather than saying, the customer, you know, they're not buying it, you know, what are we doing? We need, you know, they're not, we can't charge more. We need to be thinking about, well, from an electric vehicle standpoint, there's a lot of goodness in electric vehicles. They're a lot more responsive off the line. They're a lot quieter, right? We're looking at things like, you know, how do you turn your electric vehicle into a power source at your house so that when you're, electricity gets cut off, you could actually power your house with the vehicle. So I think, you know, from a customer standpoint, when we talk about doing the right things with our products, we shouldn't just expect the customer to pay for the cost of doing those right things. We need to be more creative, I think, as consumer companies to say, what's the other values that what we're putting together provides to the customer so that we're able to provide that more environmentally consumer good, and the customer is paying for it because the value in that total package is better. So I think we need to be doing more in that space.
And is a part of this also mm-hmm. in your lobbying work? I mean, certainly the subsidy for electrics yep. is a major player here. But then again, you know, the greenhouse gas emission standards from automobiles, these are all factors in shifting the market and the cost structure for the consumer.
Right, right, so right, exactly. And I think a real good example is our F-150, our big pickup truck, right? We went to aluminum for the F-150, and a big piece of that was the, you know, fuel economy, right? The fuel economy standards required us to go to lightweighting. We get much better fuel economy. Well, the bottom line is the F-150 customer with current gas prices, fuel economy is like number 15 on the list, right? It's not even in the top 10 in terms of their consideration, right? Well, we still want to make money on the F-150, so what we did was, with the lighter vehicle, we could actually now tow a lot more. We could actually put more payload in that vehicle. So as we emphasize these other attributes of that vehicle, we're now getting premiums for that vehicle at the same time delivering fuel economy. So again, the environmental benefits that you put into your product aren't always going to translate into customers paying for those, but there is a responsibility of the companies to get creative to figure out what is the other values that that product actually provides so that customers are paying for that and you're delivering a more environmentally friendly product.
And another example you could talk to is I just read a story that Ford is going to start producing hybrid police cars.
We are.
Which is really an interesting communication challenge of...
Absolutely. And so when you talk about, from an image standpoint, right, there are a lot of police forces throughout the U.S., particularly like, you know, LAPD and others that, you know, are really interested in a hybrid or an electrified type of a product. And, you know, what we determined, rather than saying, okay, you could have this hybrid vehicle, and oh, by the way, it's going to have less performance and it's going to be smart, right? What we focused on is the fact that one thing about police vehicles is they do a lot of idling, right? They sit and they're running a lot of equipment. That's perfect for a hybrid vehicle because if your vehicle is sitting, right, you could actually run all of that equipment off of the big batteries that are part of hybrids. So the fuel savings for the police force is huge now, right? Because they're idling, just burning up fuel. Now they're able to run that equipment off of the battery. Huge value proposition, right? And we own a big part of the police market. And we think that that's going to be an absolute win, not for only from an environment standpoint, but from a profitability standpoint.
Andy, educating consumers, shareholders, stockholders?
Well, We've wrestled with this. I think that there's a couple ways of looking at this. One is, I think what John was getting at is that for existing customers, consumers, it's quality. I mean, you're emphasizing a quality piece of the market. The market's always going to have niches where there's higher, medium, and lower end. And if you want to buy the cheapest thing, you might be able to buy something which is environmentally or not sustainable. But at the same time, you're buying something of lower quality. So to the extent that sustainability and quality go together, then that's the way to market it. And I think companies are already doing that on their own to some degree. I think the other piece of it is that we haven't talked about early education, preschool, elementary, high school education. And that's fundamental. And as kids not only become educated and become educated adults who are willing to pay more for sustainability, but they also drive what their parents do. Kids in schools learning how to recycle drove the initial recycling movement that changed parents. They changed the way that the parents work. So there's a number of things that we can do. It is hard, though, to go for an environmental organization or a company to go into their customer base or somebody else's market and say, you should be paying more because it's sustainable. Yeah. It's possible, but it's a long, heavy lift. Forest certification, wood certification is that way, but it's usually a niche market. And if it only works when the consumers begin to say, you know, this is higher quality.
And bringing up K-12, that's becoming a battleground. The Heartland Institute produced a book of an alternative view on climate change, what they call the non-governmental, intergovernmental panel on climate change, the NIPCC. And they produced tens of thousands of these and sent them to high school teachers all over the country who admittedly aren't really savvy on climate change. And so that level of communication becomes really, really, really touching.
It's absolutely critical. And we've actually partnered with some organizations and sent a reminder to those teachers and some actual real facts on what's happening. But that was really a shot across the bow.
Okay, last question. Aside from understanding the more pressing environmental problems that we face, what are some useful skills that graduates should have or acquire when working in sustainability?
because it's not often that the sustainability teams, or even if it's just a portion of your accountabilities, is at the forefront of decision making in the organization that you're in. And so being able to advance a shared agenda and embedding it into how others are getting their work done as well requires the ability to lead not through direct ownership and accountability, but through influence. So that kind of stake, that engagement, bringing that mindset of engagement and collaborative outcomes together, we find to be really important.
Yeah, and I'm going to build on the word you use, collaboration. I think collaboration is so key, and I think something that you have, you know, here at Michigan, if it's with the Graham Institute, or Erb, and others, is the fact that, you know, you are working on projects with individuals from, right, different disciplines, different areas of concentration, and that's so important because the problems that we need to solve in sustainability are really complex. Right, so you can't just be an engineer and say, "Oh, with my," because I'm an engineer. So, you know, as an engineer, I'm just going to worry about solving a problem myself. It's too complex for an engineer by themselves to solve. You need finance people, you need accounting, you need procurement people. So, I guess, you know, building that muscle, building that skill of how do you collaborate, right, with entities that aren't like you, right, disciplines that aren't like you, to actually drive toward completions of projects and solutions is so critical. And I'll tell you what. We don't have a lot of that naturally in big companies right now. We're trying to drive more of that. If you could develop that skill while you're in school here, boy, that's something that you'll have coming into companies that a lot of folks within the companies don't have already.
I completely agree with John and with John and Diane. Those are. I would add one more, and that is the ability to think innovatively and creatively as you're doing these other things. Because no matter what you learn, you're going to be faced with situations and data that you haven't encompassed before. And because the problems are one that nobody's ever seen, or the situations are one that you can't anticipate, to be able to think creatively and innovatively while being influencers and while being collaborative is key for success.
I'm going to ask you if you have any final comments that we didn't touch on, but to have you a moment to think about it, I'm just going to do a short plug that one of the sponsors of this event, the Graham Institute, is designed around this principle. It's designed to span the university, and our co-curricular activities bring students together with students in all other disciplines in the school to try and foster that kind of thinking, that kind of education. So education is trying to attend to this, but we got a long way to go, but there's an innovation here. Is there anything we didn't touch on? Any final words you'd like to have to say?
How much time do we have? Half hour?
It's fine to say no.
You're all here because you care about these things. And you're all here because you're trying to figure out, as we are, have done and are often still doing, how do we have an impact and do the best with what we can bring to bear? And my, I guess, parting message is bring that passion to bear and go big. Think about how do you drive the biggest impact wherever that is most important for you, and do it in the best way possible. That is what's going to create the excitement, and that's what's going to create outcomes that are going to help move all of us forward. So we need it badly. Go for it.
That's great. That's a great capping comment. I agree completely.
Liz, you want to bring us to a close?
Yeah, sure. So can we thank our panelists?